Now, some lessons from time spent in space from a man who seemed like a most unlikely candidate to become an astronaut. Miles O'Brien has a conversation about a most unusual career, part of our weekly series on the leading edge of science and technology.
4, 3, 2, 1. Mike Massimino went to low Earth orbit twice aboard the space shuttle, both times to repair the Hubble Space Telescope. In his new book, Spaceman, he details the long and difficult journey he took to become an astronaut.
You're afraid of heights.
Yes, I still am. I don't like this right here, Miles. I'm a little worried.
You don't swim very well.
The hardest thing for me as an astronaut was to improve my swimming skills.
Vision was a problem,
medically DQ'd because I couldn't see well enough.
And you barely got through the program at MIT. I know.
Yes.
So, really, it's completely improbable that you became an astronaut, right?
Absolutely.
We met beside the Shuttle Enterprise display at the Intrepid Sea, Air, and Space Museum in New York City, his hometown.
It occurs to me, though, that the lessons you learned all along the way there, dealing with those setbacks, with those failures, the resilience, are exactly what you need to go through to become an astronaut.
Aha, now we're getting at something. I think you're right, yes. It's not a question of being the best at something or things coming easy to you. But it's being a person that can work with others and not give up. And for me, that was part of it too. At every step of the way, when I had trouble, there were people that came in my life that helped me. It's important to go seek help when you need it and to give help when other people need it. And that is really more important than coming in with a gigantic brain into the astronaut program.
That's an important lesson for all of us, I think.
I think so, especially when you're doing things that are really hard.
It occurs to me that this book, to some degree, it's about space. But space is almost a backdrop for a completely separate story. Is that the way you view it?
I applied to be an astronaut 4 times. I was rejected 3 times before I was accepted. So it's about that, not following your dream and not giving up.
If you hadn't persevered and become an astronaut, what would you be doing today?
I'd probably be working on my next astronaut application. I think that's what I don't think.
You always made an effort to connect with, try to relate the experience to others. But I don't think I've ever heard any astronaut put words to that experience that really do it justice. Is it possible to explain, especially what it's like when you're on an EVA, on a spacewalk?
It's very emotional. So the way I try to describe it is what I was feeling. And viewing our planet was so compelling. Words like beautiful and awesome just don't do it justice. I felt that I was looking at a paradise. I was looking at heaven. I can't imagine any place being more beautiful than our planet and how lucky we are to be able to live here. And that's what I felt. That's what I was thinking at the time, which I think is a better way for me to explain it than trying to think of words that don't exist to explain to people just how beautiful it is.
That's pretty good. Not bad.
Oh, thanks. Yeah.
There was a moment on that flight where you might have ruined your stop and smell the roses moment, and that was when you almost broke the Hubble.
Yeah, we were trying to do a repair of the Space Telescope Imaging Spectrograph, but before we could do that, we had a very easy task, which was to remove a handrail with big bolts on it, but I went and stripped one of those bolts. So the solution that came up to take the handrail off was to see if I could just tear it off the telescope. I don't know if that ever would have crossed my mind, because it's so counter the way we do things, but luckily we had smart engineers that thought of it on the ground. You know, I'm inside the Hubble Space Telescope doing this million-dollar repair on this billion-dollar telescope.
Houston, you ready for this?
Yeah, we're ready.
Okay, man, so you have a go.
Here we go.
I grabbed that handrail and gave it a couple tugs, and whang, it came right off.
Final thought. Think about how fortunate we were to be alive on that day in 1969 when they walked to the moon. We were kind of sprinkled with moon dust, our generation.
Yeah, we were very lucky.
It inspired a whole generation of astronauts of your generation.
Right.
Do you worry that young people today don't have a similar inspiration?
I talk to a lot of high school students around the country. They still have that same interest, but it's just different. It's not like we had. What was given us, it's different. Now we can engage with the astronauts that are in space. I was the first person to tweet from space, but now every astronaut tweets from space and does Instagram and Snapchat and they have Facebook going. So I think it's more of a personal relationship they have with space now. They see it as more attainable than me watching my superhero Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin walking on the moon. It's like, there's no way I can do that. I think it is more engageable, and it's just different than what we had. But they still think it's very, very cool. And I don't see that interest waning. I see it as growing.
All right, Mike Massimino, thank you very much.
Thanks, Miles.
It's a pleasure. Enjoyed it.
Online, find a review of Mars, a new six-part miniseries that premiered Monday on the National Geographic Channel. That's at pbs.org/newshour.